The grace of Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Gracious good morning to you on this winter weather for Sarasota, Florida. We all have on our coats. We're glad that you are here as we gather to worship Almighty God. There are several announcements that I want to share with you. If you got a bulletin, please open it up and I'll just point out a couple things that are going on. First of all, you'll see the insert about the congregational meetings and also about the all-church picnic that will be on the 12th. So I hope that you will just kind of highlight that and put it on your, you are going to want to be here for the 12th. There's tons going on. That will be a congregational meeting. It's going to be the kids with the Super Bowl. There's going to be the lunch, and then there's an opportunity to go worship with the Hungarian church. So I hope that you'll mark that. Hi, Millers and Harpers. We're good to see you. I'm glad that you're here. Also, you'll notice in here the stuff that's going on next week is our retirement open house. Hope that you can come. We would love to be able to celebrate that with you. It's from 4 to 6 over in the community center. From the Vitality Committee, if you need a survey or have one to return from last week, please see Don Munsmay. Munsmay, raise your hand. So Munsmay's right there. So if you want a survey, he can give you one. If you want to give him one, he will take that. Also, that you will be meeting this Tuesday at 6 p.m. on Zoom. Karen Snyder will send you the link out again. So just to remind you to be ready for that on Tuesday. This week, there will not be any bell rehearsals. Matter of fact, Bells of Joy will probably not pick back up due to a couple things going on until February. Clara Kaiser is off this week as well. Tonight is the lock-in. I said I would never do a lock-in again. Never say never. So if anybody has a burning desire to do the lock-in, I will change places with them, and they can do it. And Mike's going to do it. Yeah, you're going to be with Mike. So we are going to do the lock-in. We already have about 6 to 8 kids, so we're going to look forward to that. So it should be a fun time. Let me just tell you about birthdays and anniversaries. Phyllis Hawes, Brian Fraley, Deborah Hutchison, Pat Ling, Elizabeth Natherson, and Sam Smith all have birthdays this week, anniversaries, Pam and Ralph Vitale, and Alice and Ron Shanklin, who just came in, have an anniversary this week as well. If we could sing happy birthday to our friends. Thank you very much. I invite you now to breathe in God's grace and goodness as we settle ourselves and as we begin our worship. Thank you.
Join with me now in our call to worship. Come and see what God has done.
Here is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world.
Come and see what God has done.
We have found the Messiah, the anointed one of God.
Let us worship the Almighty God. Let's pray together. Holy One, you sent the Lord Jesus Christ to save the world from sin. Teach us to follow him faithfully, proclaiming the good news that all may come to know and love the Lamb of God, in whose name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand in body or spirit as we sing our first hymn today. We are called to be disciples. Let's sing together.
You may be seated. We worship a God who is gracious and loving, a God who is slow to anger, and a God who is forgiving. With this confidence in mind, we approach God with our prayer confession, knowing God will hear and set us on the right path. Please join me today in our prayer confession. Gracious God, we come before you in need of forgiveness and grace. You call us to trust in you completely, but we do not. We are timid and fearful as we follow your lead. We justify our actions and words, though we know they are not what you require. We struggle to understand the new life Christ offers, preferring old habits to risky change. Forgive us, we pray. Help us to be born again into the life of Christ, trusting that you have included us by grace in the family of faith. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. God is for us, not against us. For that very reason, God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
So it's a special morning because I get to do children's time. So y'all want to come up? You found it. Come on. Here we go. There's no way I'm getting up. You can sit. There's no way. You'll have to help me, okay? So there's some pages for you to color on, so you can color them when you. I don't know, what's the one on the baptism? And then, I don't know. All right, so today, Karen's gonna, oh man, this is low. No, I'm down already now. So Karen's gonna talk about a couple words that we're going to listen to. And she says that Jesus says to the disciples who are following, come and see. Come and see. So I was thinking about coming and seeing, or taking a peek, or look at something. And I got a kaleidoscope. You know what that is? Well, I think I'm going to show you what it is then. So what we're going to do is I want you to look inside of, you see the little thing right there? Move the thing up and down. And go this way with it, or you can go the other way with it. Hold on, let's do this. Now try, and then pass it on. And what do you see? A bunch of blue. Flip it over again. Yeah. Has different shapes and different colors. Pass it on. And then everybody can see what we're looking at. Yep. And you can move it around. Excuse me, you can play with it. But it's a bunch of different colors and shapes. You have to see. You have to look for it. You have to look for what you need to see. So I want us to think about as we pass it on. All right, pass it on. I want us to, I know, that's pretty bright, isn't it? It looks like you're an angel.
No, I'm not.
I know we're not. We are assured that you are not. We got to look at what we're trying to find, right? So I want us to think about today about looking for the right things. Yeah, pass it on. Looking for the right things and looking for God's love in your life, in your everyday life, and look at the different ways it comes, in different colors, in different shapes. It comes in different rhythms and flows. So I want us to think about looking and seeing for God's presence and God's love in your life. Flip it over there, and then gravity will take it back down. And that's called a kaleidoscope. So there's a lot of different ways that God's love comes into your life. And flip that around there if you want to. And just remember to pay attention and to look and see God's love in your life, okay? You ready for a prayer? All right, let's pray. Great God, thank you for loving us and help us to keep our eyes on you. Open our eyes that we can see your love in our lives, and we do pray. And what do God's people say at the end of a prayer?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. All right. Now here comes the hard part.
In our scripture for today, we'll be hearing about John's baptism, and then we'll we'll hear about John baptizing Jesus, and then we'll be hearing about Jesus and maybe calling some of his first disciples. And so as I pour the waters, we're reminded that God has called us to come and see and be baptized in the waters of his grace and mercy and forgiveness.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, you know us inside and out, and you call us to serve you. And yet we are sometimes hesitant, afraid, and wish we can remain hidden. So now empower us to listen for your call, and equip us to answer your call. And encourage us every day to follow you wherever that call leads. We know that following you matters and makes the biggest difference in our lives and the lives of others. So keep nudging us to listen, to come and see. Lord of mercy and justice, so many have gone before us working to bring peace to our country and our world. Their footsteps seem too big to step into to continue the work you have called us all to embody. So we hesitantly step one step at a time, bringing your seeds of hope and justice and peace in a world that is in need of a better way, a more excellent way. So we lift up our country, our leaders, and pray for the healing of our country, reconciliation, forgiveness, and peace. Help us to figure a way to solve our problems. We especially pray for the people in Ukraine and the war that continues there. Stretch out your strong right hand, O Lord, and bring the reckoning that leads to restoration. But not only there, we remember the brokenness all around us, homes where abuse is hidden, communities where divisions fester, and the many other injustices of all the nations that leave men and women in need of deliverance. Holy One, you love righteousness and justice, and the earth is filled with your steadfast love. As you have loved us and as you love the world, be a moving force this day that brings peace. And now, Lord of compassion, we pray for those special people in our lives who need a healing, who need your comforting presence. Surround those who care, the doctors, nurses, staff, therapists, everyone who gives care to those special people in our lives. We also lift up for your comfort and presence for those who are grieving. We ask you to surround them with the peace that passes all understanding. We pray for warmth and shelter and clothing and food for all those who are without. Lord, strengthen us today and every day to offer care where care is needed, to be a presence where presence is needed, to embody your love where your love is needed. We ask you, Holy One, to hear this prayer and hear the prayer that we say as your beloved together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to take a moment now just to thank you for your continued support of our mission and ministry here at Pine Church. We're able to do amazing ministry and transforming this community and country and world because we choose to make a difference by our giving of our time and talents and treasures. So we give you thanks. We give each other thanks for this blessing. And want to remind you that there are a number of ways in which you can continue the online, the text, the mail, and the Shelby app. Also, the plates are at the doors as you go out. So let's just continue to remember how blessed we are, and knowing and trusting that all blessings come from from God. So let's stand and together sing our doxology.
Be seated. Today we are following lectionary. We are doing the gospel reading from the lectionary, and it comes from the gospel according to John. We're in the first chapter, starting with verse 29 and going through verse 42. Listen now for God's word as God speaks words of wisdom and encourage and challenge to you this day. The next day, he, that is John the Baptist, saw Jesus coming toward him, and he declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and testified that this is the chosen one." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon, and he said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated the Anointed. And he brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Lowly.
That was lovely. Thank you. Please join me in a word of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. All right, I just kind of need to confess, I have no idea, but today I'm nervous. So today I'm a little nervous and I'm a little edgy. So if I cry a little bit, please bear with me. A lot. I cry a lot, bear with me. So I want to start off by reading a little excerpt from Anne Lamott. Anybody here familiar with Anne Lamott? Oh, she writes wonderful books, And this one is entitled Traveling Mercies. And one of her chapters, which got my attention, and you'll see why when you hear the name of the chapter, it says, Why I Make Sam Go to Church. Sorry, Lindsay. So this is what Lamott writes. She writes about her son, Sam, who is 7 years old, who's the only child among his group of friends who goes to church. Sound kind of familiar to today? Sometimes he doesn't want to go, she says, but she doesn't let him get away with it. She explains, I make him go because I can. I outweigh him by nearly 75 pounds, but that is only part of it. The main reason is that I want to give him what I found in the world, which is to say a path and a little light to see by. Most of the people I know who have what I want, which is to say purpose, heart, balance, gratitude, joy, are the people with a deep sense of spirituality. They are people in community who pray or practice their faith, people banding together to work on themselves and for human rights. They follow a brighter light than the glimmer of their own candle. They are part of something beautiful. I love this story from Anne Lamott. It resonates with me and reminds me why being part of a faith community is so important. For I have told you many times, I am a product of the faith community in more ways than you might imagine. For me, the faith community is a place where I find purpose and heart and balance and gratitude and joy. It's in the faith community that I find strength and guidance to be a more faithful follower of Jesus Christ. And it's in the faith community that I look for the light that's brighter than the glimmer of my own candle. And as she said, it's in the faith community that I find this deep sense of spirituality that is a part of who we are. Our scripture for today retells two key moments in Jesus' life. Very first, his baptism and the call of his first disciples. And in this, it highlights the importance of a faith community and discipleship that is a vital component of such a community. So we have been doing a very low-key scale on stewardship this year. But we're taking in the vital community, the vitalness of what it means to be a community of faith. And our scripture today talks about it, and I think Anne Lamott hits right upon it in her writings. In John's account of Jesus' baptism, it's very succinct and to the point. That is probably why we don't often hear of this account of Jesus' baptism that we're familiar with. Instead, we hear more of maybe Matthew's or Luke's or Mark's. You notice in John's account, Jesus doesn't say a word. It's all John retelling it. And in John's account, we don't get the full, or we don't even hear about the Jordan River or anything else. We just hear a very brief understanding. It's a first, it's a telling of an eyewitness from John's perspective. But we do get what is important from this passage is that John points the way so others come to recognize and ultimately follow Jesus Christ. When he is with some of his disciples, that is John out there, he points and says, look guys, there's the Lamb of God. Interestingly, it only took that comment from John for his disciples to be intrigued enough to decide that they might be worth their while to follow. and see why John claimed that this man named Jesus was the Lamb of God. The two disciples of John approach Jesus, and a conversation ensues, and they say to Jesus, "Where are you going?" And Jesus says simply to them, an invitation, "Come, come, come, come and see for yourself." It is that simple, come and see, that I want to focus all on today. Come and see, I believe, establishes the theme of the ministry for Christians. It's the message of the church that we are to say to others, come and see, come and see. We're to be a place that's inviting and welcoming. I think that is the key to what it means to be the church that Jesus has called us to be. We are to welcome others to come and see what we have found, why we come on Sunday morning, why it's important to be a part of a faith community. Madeline L'Engle writes this, "We do not draw people," listen to me very carefully too, so I'm now preaching to you my words I want you to hear. We do not draw people to Christ by loudly discrediting what they believe, by telling them that they are wrong or how right we are, but by showing them a light that is so lovely that they will want with all their hearts to know the source of it. Jesus calls us to be people in community who pray and practice our faith, banding together to work on ourselves so we can be the best of who we are, but also to work for human rights of all people, regardless of race and gender and political alliances and sexual orientation and appearance. It doesn't matter if you're wearing your Sunday best to come and see. It doesn't matter if you have washed your hair the night before or if you have tattoos all over your body. The invitation to all is to come and see. Before Christmas, I mentioned an article about the nuns and the duns, the nuns, N-O-N-E-S, and the duns, D-O-N-E-S, and I wanted to share some of it with you. It was written by Sue Pizer-Yoder and Stephen Simmons, and the reason why I want to share with you is that I know, and I've already heard from several of you, that you're beginning to feel anxious. And you should feel anxious. That's normal. I'm anxious about what's going to happen, not only to you, most importantly, but also in my life as well. I know among your worries, and this will pertain, apply regardless of our retirement, is that you look around and you wonder, will this church be here in 10 years, 15 years, 20 years? We wonder what the future looks like. Where are the young families, the children, the youth? Again, let me say to you, they're out there. They're around, even though you don't see them on Sunday mornings. I guess the question is, have we really invited them to come and see? So my pep talk for you, which I have kind of, in quotations, named faithful living, that there is much to be grateful and hopeful for. See, I believe that you, the church, Pine Shores, is in the right position to make some necessary changes, and changes need to happen. That's good. We need to explore new things and embrace faithful ministry that God has in store. Some of the things are going to stick and work, and some are not. That's okay. We need to do some creative things and think outside the box. You guys would have never let me do that if we hadn't gone through some COVID. That there. And regardless, we now bring a little bit of drinks in the church, even though Libby still grimaces when she sees people with their cups now and then. Who knows? I'm hoping one day that maybe these pews might be taken out and it might be a different configuration. You never know. So all this leads me to also talk about this article about the nuns and the dun, because I found it helpful. So let me explain. The nuns are, remember, those who check on any survey that what? When they talk about religious affiliation, they say they have none. And the duns are those people who have been in church, who are, I don't know the best word, I guess they're kind of done. They're done with institutional church. They're not done with spirituality. but they're done getting up on Sunday morning and coming to church. So in this article, Yoder and Simmons interviewed over 200 folks with either no religious affiliation or who were no longer going to church. In preparation for their book, hear us out, 6 questions on belonging and belief, which I understand is supposed to come out sometime this year. So here's my 2 cents. That might be a book that the council might want to read, or it might be a good Sunday school class book, maybe both. So let me tell you about the nuns and the duns. So when these people went to talk to the nuns and the duns, they wanted to talk about when they talk about life. What do they talk about when they talk about life? In other words, what do young adults with no connection to a faith community say when they're given the chance to share their values, their hopes, and their goals? So when I talk about young adults, in this one in particular, the age group was 18 through 39. So if you're in that age group, you are a young adult. If you're not in that age group, I guess you're an old adult. So these are for the young adults. So, and as they explored it, they interviewed some basic questions about inspiration, belonging, values, adversity, legacy, and shifts in faith. And what they found when they did this, one of the very striking things they found, there's always surprises when you do these kind of things. They were surprised at how many times the people said, "Thank you for asking." Because guess what? No one asked these questions of them. There is no place that they get to talk about these things. Not with family or friends or coworkers. There is no setting that addresses these questions for them. Another surprise was, this group that they talk about, they were able and ready to talk about their doubts, their regrets, their overall mental health, their personal baggage, generally viewing these as opportunities for growth rather than sources of embarrassment and shame. So let me just say, these young adults, they are not my mom and dad's generation. Growing up, I never saw my mom and dad have an argument. We didn't talk about finances. I didn't know a lot of things. We didn't share openly. These 18 to 30-year-olds responded with open, they were open and they were vulnerable to sharing their experiences, almost like as if they were in a counseling session. So, hear this loud and clear. If you want the 18 to 39 people to come to church, they have little use for dogma, doctrines, or creeds. And in general, they feel no need to have their belief system all figured out. The author said they were often struck by the openness to mystery and awe and wonder in which they often expressed. They frequently found that the nuns and the duns did not find faith communities open to their questions, their wonderments, and their doubts. Listen, you can come with me to the lock-in tonight. This is really talking about a lot of those kids that we will see tonight. They have questions, and they wonder, and they have doubts. And they are, in fact, quite curious and open to safe places. Listen to this. Safe places where they can voice these beliefs without fear of judgment, correction, or exclusion. And they are quite comfortable not having answers to every question and living into the mystery. Now, here's the interesting thing about this. I got this little article, and I think I'll give it to Libby. She's a good person to give this to, because she will read it. So it's entitled, "The Nuns and the Duns and Presbyterians." So here's the good news for Pine Shores. The nuns and the duns share many values and aspirations with those in faith traditions, particularly with Presbyterians. Here's what they said. First, they want to be good neighbors. And this extends beyond the circle, their immediate family and friends, to embrace the wider community and, indeed, the world. Many of them expressed having a desire to make a difference in both their professional lives and in their relationships with others. They often had an acute sense of social justice and wanted to find avenues through which to pursue it. While they wouldn't use Reform parlance to describe the world as the theater of God's glory, which I had to remind Bruce to tell me who did that, is Kierkegaard. Go back and do some reading of Søren Kierkegaard and you will hear about the theater of God. They did view the world as an arena in which they are called to serve and advocate for others in a broad and inclusive way. So my pep talk of faith to you, because this is my really last chance to do this, don't be afraid. You're not alone. This is God's church. God has plans for you. I will remember back when we, do you remember when we did natural church development, evangelism? Do you remember when we did that? Oh, it was probably 20 years ago. And the leader who came and said at that time, God has given you this space, this marvelous space to do ministry. That is true. God has called you at this time in this place to look at what you can do. And Jesus gives us the words. Pretty easy. Why don't you come and see? Why don't you come and see? Why don't you? Just come. Please, just come and see. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we are often very reluctant to share our faith with other people. We are so quick to judge. And at many times, we don't want to extend that grace. We think that we're either too young or too old or don't know the right words. And yet, you have given us all the tools that we need to be faithful disciples. Sometimes it's the easiest things that we need to turn our attention to. Let us not be afraid. Let us be bold in inviting and in welcoming. Let us be open to new things and challenges and gifts. Let us listen and not judge. Let us speak the words authentically and genuinely. Come. Come and see. Amen. I invite you now to stand with me as we affirm our faith by using the affirmation that you will see in the bulletin. It comes from a brief statement of faith that's in the gray box, and it's also up on the screen. Together we say, we trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor, and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed, blessing the children, healing the sick, binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe in the gospel. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to remain standing as we sing our final hymn, Open My Eyes That I May See, 451. Friends, this has been God's church from the beginning, and it will be God's church until the kingdom is fully realized here. You are a vital part of this church. You have gifts to give. You have people that you can say, come and see. And even if they just walk through these doors for just a brief time, I hope they'll find some faith community, because we're in this together, to let people know that this is a safe place, that they can share their doubts and their dreams, their questions and their wonder, their hopes and their aspirations, as they search to be the best that they can be and to be a part of that brighter light. Come and see. What wonderful invitation. So now go, knowing that you are loved, that you are held in the hands of Almighty God, and that God loves you today and tomorrow and forever. Go, my dear friends, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.